Hi everyone, this is Trey Parker.
Hi, this is Matt Stone.
And we're back for another thrilling round of commentary
minis.
Yeah.
This is season 8.
Yeah. And we like to do short commentaries because really, honestly, we just don't have that much to say about each episode. I wish we did, but we don't.
This was the first episode of season 8 called Good Times with Weapons.
I'm usually able to remember these by kind of remembering them by writer's retreats, as in where we went to come up with some of these episodes before the season. And I remember this one when we went to Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
Mm.
Four seasons.
It was pretty great. Skiing.
We did snowboarding and
yeah.
But actually had it was also, you can always tell when we had a really good retreat and when they weren't so good. This was a really good one. We came up with a lot of great ideas. And this idea, we sort of knew right away when we hit on this idea of doing an anime show and the kids becoming anime character. We weren't sure if animation department could pull it off, so we had that big question to go through, and then we were having our, you know, storyboard department start to draw up a lot of these characters, and then going through a lot of headaches of like, well, yeah, that looks good, but we can't animate that, you know, in the time, you know, we need 6 months to do this. And so it was basically us coming back and saying, hey, we want it to look like anime, and we have our usual 6 days to do it all in.
Right. And but, they did a great job.
They did a great job.
Yeah. It's really pretty, it's pretty convincing. The other thing I remember about this episode, I remember the key thing when we decided it was funny was when we just pictured a big anime character talking like Cartman. You know, the idea that they would change the look, but they would just have their own voices. That's when we kind of decided it would be funny.
Yeah. And this season was also, we were sort of right in the middle, right starting Team America. So I remember we'd actually done a shoot and we had shot some scenes of Team America and realized how fucking hard that was going to be and sort of how screwed we were. And so I remember being on this writer's retreat in Jackson Hole and constantly getting calls from Scott Rudin giving us notes on what we had shot and having to kind of do that at the same time and kind of being really thankful to be back to be back at South Park after trying to shoot puppets.
And I also remember this was the episode after the Janet Jackson Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Because the end of this episode kind of references that with her boobie falling out. So it was right after that. And that might be it about this episode.
Yeah, we should probably get to the next one because it's a lot better.
You see, guys, this is why Jews can't be ninjas.
This is the second show that aired in season 8. Called, was it called Up the Down Steroid?
Up the Down Steroid, as in Up the Down Staircase, which was a really bad play that a lot of people like me had to do in high school.
This is a great opening because they're playing, if you notice, they're playing the Bill Curtis board game.
For the second time. There was another show earlier where they played. This time it gets no explanation, though. This has an interesting history because what happened with this was starting it around, I think it was around season 3 or 4, we had this idea where we wanted Cartman to join the Special Olympics. And we had even told it to Debbie Liebling at Comedy Central and different people, and we talked about it at writers' retreats. And we could just never come up, we never felt satisfied. We're like, well, we could never, just like, that seemed like a kind of a trite idea, and it's just so, it was sort of base, and just like, well, okay, so Cartman pretends to be retarded and joins the Special Olympics. Like, what's the really funny, crazy thing about it? And we could just never get, we just didn't feel like it was worthy of a 21-minute show. But then we basically at the retreat, we came up with the idea of Jimmy, you know, doing the whole thing about steroids, and what if you're at the Special Olympics and a handicapped kid is doing steroids, and basically telling that whole story. That seemed like a big idea to us, and an idea that, you know, had a theme and had a point and had a message and all this stuff. And so we were really happy because we're like, oh, now we can do the Cartman thing as just a little runner. Because it's not the A story, it's just this little thing going on while the main story of Jimmy is going on. And then, I can't remember if it was while we were making it or right after, but someone said, oh, Fox is making this movie about what's his name, Jackass?
Johnny Knoxville
being, you know, pretending to be handicapped to join the Special Olympics. And we're like, really? Wow, they can make a whole movie out of that? That's, you know, whatever. And we just went on with our show, and then when that show came out, people were like, well, South Park already did that, and they anyway got into this big mess where a lot of people were starting to say, yeah, you ripped off South Park, which we don't think they did, because it is one of those ideas as a writer that's, again, pretty base, and you can come up, a lot of people can come up with pretty easily. But then they tried to turn around on us, some of the people over there, and were like, well, they stole it from us. They knew we were making this movie, and they stole this idea. And like our reaction was like, dude, we didn't even think it was a good enough idea for a 20-minute episode. Like, how you made it in a movie, we don't know. But sort of that's the way the whole thing went down.
Yeah, that's our story behind this episode. Yeah. Also, this character right there, the one that gives Jimmy the steroids, his drawing is based on Sean from How's Your News.
No.
He looks just like him. There's another funny story that goes along with this, which was when I acted like a disabled person to get into Magic Mountain for free one time.
Oh, yeah.
A long time ago, when we first moved to Los Angeles.
Matt and I were actually in L.A. bored, and we didn't have enough money, so we were trying to figure out what to do, and we went to Magic Mountain, and Matt put his baseball cap on backwards, which is a big story.
Like, really, like, hot. I had a big afro at that point, and so I put the baseball hat, like, just perched on top of my afro, just kind of sitting there, so, you know, like a retarded person would.
And you got him for half price.
I should have joined the Special Olympics. Could have won. Maybe. That's actually my favorite part of the show, is the fact that Cartman can't win the Special Olympics.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the whole, you know, the obvious joke is that somebody joins the Special Olympics to win, but Cartman can't even
do it.
Let's see, what else is going on? Oh, this is the whole thing where we call out Barry Bonds and those guys at the end of this.
Which, and by the way, we called out Barry Bonds, what was this now, 2 years ago?
Oh, yeah.
This was like way before people were calling out Barry Bonds, so I'm pretty proud of that. Now everyone's calling him out. All right, we'll go on to the next one.
Okay.
So this is Passion of the Jew, and this was, we knew on the retreat, I think it was on the retreat that we were starting to see the numbers from Mel Gibson's movies, and we were just like, wow, this thing's just doing gangbusters. And I guess on the retreat it hadn't come out yet. So on the retreat we knew his movie was coming out, and we figured, yeah, let's do something about that, but we hadn't quite figured it out. And we used to talk about this episode at every writer's meeting, like trying to figure out sort of what our take on it could be and what our point was. And the only thing I really remember about this episode was being so bummed out when we were, you know, one of those shows where on Wednesday morning when we're walking out of the building, you know, having been here for 24 hours, and we're walking out at 7:30 in the morning just going, man, that show sucks.
That's a stinker.
That's so
I remember feeling
bad.
That way too. That just wasn't very good. Other people love it.
And we started getting the calls like that the next day of people going, oh my God, that was amazing. We're like, what? Are you serious? And it was just one of those things, I think we had talked about it so much and we knew, you know, so many other directions we could go, and we just sort of ran out of time. And I just watched it again the other day, actually, and it is, I mean, what the central idea is funny enough to kind of sustain it all, but it does kind of fall apart at the end.
The flash scene is pretty pretty silly. But the I remember the thing that really helped us when we keyed in on the fact that most of Mel Gibson's movies involve physical torture and coming to some kind of, like, you can't, I don't know, what would you say, like, it would not even, like, you could tell that Mel Gibson was attracted to Jesus' story, not by Jesus' message, but by the fact he was tortured.
Right.
Like, that's, you know, if you look at Lethal Weapon, he's tortured. Obviously, Braveheart. It's like he only likes movies that involve physical torture.
Right.
And redemption through that, I guess.
And there really was a lot of, when The Passion came out, there was a lot of stories and a lot of people going, wow, that's really, really made me, you know, think about my faith and want to be a better Christian. And it's like, why? Because he got beat up a lot worse than you thought? Like, what does that have to do anything to do with anything? And it's like, well, like, he got his ass kicked more than I thought he did, so I better be a better Christian. And it's kind of like, kind of made me think that, is that what that whole religion is based on? And kind of bum me out.
At first, when we did this episode, I was definitely like, well, I think Mel Gibson is, you know, you'd read some of his comments about the Holocaust, you think, well, that guy's an anti-Semitic weirdo. But actually, the more that I think about, and you thought, well, yeah, this movie's success was this weird fluke, but it kind of was genius, the idea of taking that story, making it basically a bloodbath, but then doing it all in that Aramaic, because you know that they were saying the cheesiest lines that if they were in English you'd be laughing at the fucking screen, but it's like, and you just couldn't laugh at it. It's actually perfect. It kind of bulletproofs your movie. And so his new movie's coming out, Apocalypto,
right?
And it's the same thing. He's doing it in some ancient Mayan language.
Can you imagine? Yeah,
it's fucking,
if like Braveheart was
idea.
All done in a language you couldn't understand, you'd be like, this is the coolest movie ever made, because none of the cheesy
smart.
Lines would be there.
Yeah, there's nobody going, we've got to get out of here. Like, there's none of that shit to laugh at. It's really pretty genius. And I just watched Mad Max the other day, or I watched Road Warrior, Mad Max 2, and I kind of got stoked, like, now with Mel Gibson's current, like, total, like, torture, weird obsession, if he does Mad Max 4, it could be pretty good. It could do it in some weird new language.
Some weird language. Some new language.
Seriously, I'm kind of like when we did this episode, I was kind of bummed on Mel Gibson, and now I think he's awesome.
I think Road Warrior is one of the best movies ever made, and not he made it. He didn't make it, so it's not a credit.
But
to
he's
him.
Pretty good in it. Yeah. That's a good fucking movie. Anyway, that's a good movie.
Let's get out of here.
How could the Jews do that to Jesus?
So this episode is called "You Got F'd in the A," and it was based on this experience that we had. It was we went with Kyle McCullough, who's our main writer, and his girlfriend, and we went to the Magic Johnson Theaters down in South Central to watch this movie called "You Got Served," which is the worst movie in the world, but. Seeing it with an all-black audience was a pretty amazing experience. People were literally dancing in the aisles, and it made for such a fun movie experience that I kind of vowed at that point I would never go see any movie unless I went to Magic Johnson Theaters, which I haven't really upheld that end of my bargain. The bargain, but so this episode was based on that really terrible movie. So if you want to see it, it's called "You Got Served."
And it's basically just the same thing.
Which is sort of we just kind of ripped it off. And About 6 months ago, I met this guy at a bar, and he was like, "Oh, I got to talk to you. I'm the guy who I produced You Got Served." And I was like, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." And it was like, "You guys did that South Park thing about it." And I was like, "Wow, you produced it. Who directed that movie? Because it's really terrible."
Oh, hello there, children.
Chef, we just got served.
Oh, boy. Well, come on inside, children. I'll make you some cocoa. Have a seat, children.
So that tells you what kind of movie it was.
I remember this one lifted our spirits up, though, because we thought Passion of the Jew was so bad, and then we thought this one was really good. We like this one. I think we're putting this one in one of our 10 best CDs or whatever it is. But
I like when Little Kim is really, really little and says, "What's up, niggas?" There's a lot of funny stuff in this episode. This episode turned out really good.
Yeah. This is one of those that was good enough that we were out of here by like 4 a.m. on Tuesday, because it was... because I liked it. And actually, as we're saying this right now, we're recording all these. It's Sunday night, and we're doing an episode right now called about Cartman being rehabilitated by the dog whisperer. And as it is right now, it's like maybe, we have like maybe 15 minutes of it figured out, and I just decided about an hour ago that I hate it, and I'm going to have to rewrite everything. So it's... as I'm saying this, we're like in big trouble because we shouldn't even be sitting here doing commentary. Because we're in one of those situations where we have a bunch of scenes and they don't work together, they don't make any sense, and there's giant holes to fill, and we're in trouble. So it won't be a 4 a.m. week this week. That will move on.
Well, then it's about time you learn.
This is awesome. Another one of our favorite episodes, actually. This was part of our triple slam we did in this... between You Got F'd in the A, Osimo, and the Jeffersons. We were pretty stoked on those episodes. We really hit a groove, but I remember Osimo, the whole idea of Cartman being a robot and all this, that was something we came up on the writer's retreat, and we started writing some of it actually before the season started, so we'd have some time off. And then one of our friends named Dave decided to get married during our little 3-day break, which is all we get during our whole run. And so we had to rush down to Hawaii for his wedding and then rush back and finish this episode. So that was kind of tough.
The whole thing about this episode, I guess when we started really laughing about it, it was when it came the idea that he just had to go lame. He had to stay as a robot and say lame. That was pretty much it. Like once we had that, we laughed about that quite a bit, and then we knew that maybe we had an episode here.
It's just sort of it's just my little thing of like, we always know if we put Cartman and Butters together, it's gonna be pretty good. And why didn't we do that? We didn't do that this season at all. We didn't put Cartman and Butters together. That's where we messed up this week, I think. But
isn't the Sony robot called Osimo or
the Honda?
Or Honda robot? Osimo?
It's a Osimo.
Osimo.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe that's where. Maybe it has. I don't know. Maybe it's kind of like Osimo. Maybe. I can't really remember anything else about this episode.
Yeah, I just remember we liked it a lot.
All right, let's move on. That's good.
You okay, Osimo?
Yes, Osimo is fine.
This is the Jeffersons, this is another one of those ideas where we resisted it for a long time just because it was such a, again, such a base idea and just
sort of cliche,
like,
really.
Yeah, I was like, oh, we're going to make fun of Michael Jackson, you know. And so for the longest time, we were just like, no, no, no. In any writer's meeting, we'd avoid any Michael Jackson joke, any Michael Jackson idea, because it just seemed so base. And usually when we ignore things because they're so base, then we finally do them, they're really funny because, you know, base is funny sometimes. But
yeah.
This all had to do with the wedding, I remember still, too, because we got so behind and so messed up schedule-wise by the wedding that we were like, oh, okay, we just got to think of something. We got to make it simple. It all has to take place in South Park, and we just got to, and we're like, okay, let's just do Michael Jackson. It'll just be a dumb thing, and whatever. It's, you know, episode 7 of 8. It just won't be perfect. Or 6 of 7, and it just won't be perfect, and we'll move on. And then sort of about halfway, we'd already animated some stuff with Michael Jackson and done some things, and then suddenly it sort of dawned on us to really make it more about Blanket, about Michael Jackson's kid, than about Michael Jackson himself. And then that's when suddenly the show seemed to have this heart and a point and all this stuff. And that's, we always,
it was kind of like to make the point that Michael Jackson is a freak is really kind of whatever, and to make, you know, there's a lot of point things that people have talked about with Michael Jackson, but the one at the time just seemed like maybe something new was the idea that, like, once you have a kid, it, you know, you just can't, you know, be a freak. It's about the kid too.
And he would always hide behind the thing of like, I'm just a child. I have the heart of a child. And people like, weren't saying, well, you're
now
a father, so that doesn't matter what you are. You know, and it's just like,
you can't ride little train sets around anymore.
That's like a pretty sweet Michael Jackson drawing. That's my Michael Jackson impersonation.
It's pretty good. This was, I mean, we studied that. What was that guy's name? Martin Brashear.
Yeah.
Show that came out, and we just watched that about 10 times. He's like, you're ignorant, man. You're ignorant.
Yeah. The more you watch Michael Jackson, the more you're just like, wow, man. Like, you really start to go, what can we exaggerate to make fun of?
All this shit is in the Martin Brashear documentary. He's running around saying all that shit.
I just like to come out here and look at this tree.
It's like, it's so silly. I just added all those.
It was like, there's definitely some ripoff of one of our favorite things to watch is Bo Selecta, which is a British show in England, and he does a Michael Jackson impersonation that's awful. It's like, doesn't sound like him at all, but that's kind of the point. But he does the jumbo.
So awesome.
But he just does it. He just puts on a rubber mask that's super bad with kind of like a beard and glasses, and then just, he's like, I'm Michael Jackson. Just talks like that. It's pretty great. You got to check it out if you can.
Yeah, you should watch that. Bo Selecta. It's funny. I mean, this was the time. Yeah, this was the Martin Brashear. This was after the trial, right? Or was this before the trial?
I think it was. No, it was before the trial.
It was?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Because the Brashear thing had sort of had pretty recently happened.
And that's the thing, is Michael Jackson, somebody, him or his handlers thought, you know what? I just got to get on TV for an hour. If people could just see me for an hour, they'll come around. They'll think I'm not a freak.
That didn't work.
That didn't work so well.
I remember we had to, I can't remember how it actually ended up, I would have to see it, but there was a big fight in this one with Comedy Central about the scene when Michael Jackson and Cartman are laying in bed. I think first they just fully made out for a long time, and then I think they ended up, cutting that out.
That's right out of the Martin Brashear documentary too, where he goes,
me, gimme, me, chain.
God. This is really like a documentary of Michael Jackson.
All right, we better move on.
Mr. Jefferson, you're so awesome. Mr. Jefferson.
This episode is called Goobacks, and this beginning is from Terminator, right? It's a Terminator 2. One of them. When he comes from the future.
Yeah.
It starts on the sign.
Yeah.
And this was obviously an allegory for immigration. We want to do like an immigration show, and the idea that the immigrants would come from the future instead of from another country. And it's like, so it's actually pretty, you know, it's interesting because like this episode's so, it's got that, like, you know, again, it's working on some allegorical level, although it's obviously about immigrants. And then, but the one right before it, Mr. Jefferson, is just literally Michael Jackson. So it's, I don't know, sometimes I think these ones where we do the, they both can, you know, can be good, but I like these ones where it ends up just being like this, you know, working on several levels.
Yeah, I remember this idea we kicked around for a long. I mean, we came up with it at the writer's retreat, the whole idea about, you know, people from the coming back from the future to find jobs, and we thought that was really clever and funny and everything. But then for the longest time, we were kicking it around trying to figure out, all right, how do you tell this story and not have it just be a bunch of news beats in a row? And because there's kind of a lot of explaining you have to do. And
ultimately,
we were like, we kept kicking around and saying, no, that way you just have to have a bunch of news beats too, and da da da. And then basically it was the end of the season and we had no other ideas. So we're like, all right, fuck it, we're just going to do it with a bunch of news beats. So basically, like 5 minutes of the beginning of the show is just a bunch of news beats.
Because it is hard. It's a kind of a difficult concept to get across.
So. And I remember when it came out, a lot of people were like, well, that wasn't funny. You know, it was just a lot of news beats. And it was like, this is one of those episodes you don't sit around and laugh your ass off at, but you kind of like laugh maybe later thinking about the point.
Yeah. This is like, in right now when we're doing this commentary, there's this huge immigration protest tomorrow across the country, this time by immigrants who've come to America, because this idea of like, they took our jobs, is just comes around about every 3 or 4 years in America.
Yeah.
And it's just that whole thing of like, God damn, are you really going there again? You really, they're taking our jobs. Like, shut the fuck up. Every 3 years, somebody brings it up, and it just like gets to be a big thing, and then it kind of goes away. So
that's actually, that's right. You know what? That makes me realize
every time. It's like every 2 years, this happens.
We came up with they took our jobs on the retreat a year before this one. Remember, it was the one with Norman Lear in Arizona.
Yeah,
and that's where we first came up with they took our jobs. And so we actually came up with this idea like a year before, and spent a year trying to figure out how to do it without news beats, and then finally just did.
Just
it
had to be the news beats. They took our jobs. Cartman, just keep your mouth shut. Yeah, there it is.
Here we go. And now it's going to be news beats for about 3 minutes now. And we tried to, you know, interject other things in between news beats, but it just didn't work.
You know what? People like watching the news.
Yeah, okay. I mean, what the hell? You watch news for half an hour. This is only like 4 minutes.
And it's like fake news. And we split it up between different newscasters.
Yeah, we thought that was clever.
Live team coverage. It's all that shit. His condition is stable and speculation. The other good part of this episode too is in the end when they decide if they go gay,
right,
then there'll never be anybody in the future.
Totally makes sense.
And then Noah can go back and take their jobs.
So they basically have a giant gay off. And everyone gets in a pile and gets gay.
There was also a lot of kind of back and forth on how the humans from the future would look, and that's our kind of, well, everyone's going to be kind of sort of brown.
Right. There won't be any races anymore.
There won't be any races, and everyone will be hairless.
Yeah.
And that's what we'll all look like in the future.
But it does make perfect sense, because I do think everyone's probably going to be broke in the future.
Broke and bald and...
And wearing jumpsuits. Although you're supposed to be wearing jumpsuits now. When I watch movies they made in the 60s and they show, you know, the year 2006, where there were always jumpsuits.
We did the little future beat in this, didn't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, we ended up doing that. We had a whole bunch of story that happened in Little Future.
Yeah, we had a lot of ideas for that. We could have made a feature out of this. It just would have been about 30 minutes of news beats, probably.
The news feature. Yeah. I think this episode is good.
All right, we'll see you on the next one.
This is in contrast to, say, Back to the Future rules, where back and forth is possible. And, of course, Time Rider rules, which are just plain silly.
So, we'll start this episode by saying that we had said it was Sunday night before, and it's now Thursday afternoon, and we finished the Cartman episode we were working on. It turned out okay.
I think it turned out pretty good. Yeah. And as you can hear in my voice, I have a totally sore throat.
Yeah. So but we're in a much better mood now because the run's over and now we have some vacation time. So, but this episode actually started, you know, this is all called season 8, but really this was the second part. So this was several months after the first episodes you've been seeing. And it was quite different because what we had done in between Goobacks, the last one you saw, and this one was the movie Team America, which basically about killed us. And we spent all summer getting that movie shot and made, and then we had like a 2 week, 3 week post-production to get it all edited and scored, and it was just a nightmare. And what ended up happening was that we had like a day. We always have these writer's retreats where we go to come up with ideas. We had like 1 day in Scottsdale, I think.
Yeah, I think that was it. I remember Team America was released on October 15th. We went to the premiere, and then we went to New York to do press. And then we were back in the office on Monday, and this episode was on the air on Wednesday.
Yeah. And I remember the retreat. All we came up with was this idea, because the elections were coming.
It was the Kerry and Bush election.
We were all talking about, well, are you going to vote? Are you going to vote for? And we were like, I don't think we're going to vote. And then one of our friends was like, that's lame. You guys don't vote. And it's like, well, what are your choices? You know, you're going to go pick between a douche and a turd sandwich. And we were just like, well, there's a show. So it was sort of like we were being asked by a lot of people.
That's how we, there's a show.
Yeah, we were being asked by a lot of people who we were going to vote for. And we were like, watch the show and you'll know what we're going to do. Because this totally is exactly how we felt about the elections. Everyone getting so up your ass about voting when, you know, the choices you were given, it just, what was the point? I honestly did not care which of those two people was president because I despised them both. So I just didn't see the point. And then, you know, that's when you get letters from people like Sean Penn saying, how dare you say, don't worry about voting.
Yeah, that was just, this wasn't the episode, but we said a few things in a Rolling Stone interview that precipitated the famous Sean Penn letter, or famous to us at least, because we remember it.
Because it was just that point, basically, of like, well, why, if there was like a guy that I thought was really going to make the country better and be a stand-up guy, I would definitely go support that guy. But if I'm not going to play your little bullshit game of like, here's the two people you get to pick between, now go out and pick one. So that was basically all we said, and Sean Penn wrote back saying, you know, how dare you say don't vote, because you have an opportunity to get George Bush out of office. And it was so smug, because it was like, how do you even know we want George Bush out of office, you fucking fag? So it's just basically like, but really what it was Team America had just come out, and he was super pissed off that we'd made fun of him in Team America, because how dare you make fun of Sean Penn? It's pretty funny.
No, that's this episode. I like the end of this episode where he does vote. It doesn't change the outcome, but everyone's really happy.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of the point of voting. Yeah.
Now your vote didn't matter.
Yeah. So that was the story behind Douche and Turd. Huh?
You hate butters. God damn it, you guys. Butters is our friend.
So this episode is called Something Walmart This Way Comes. And it starts with, I think, what happens in a lot of small towns in America, which is somebody runs in and screams, oh my God, it's here. And they all run over and the new Walmart opens and everyone's super fucking stoked.
Because
they can finally buy stuff for cheap.
There was tons of articles coming out about people being angry that Walmart was opening and Providence going to ruin our town. And a Walmart actually had just opened up in Evergreen, where I went to high school up in the mountains. And people were like, there's a lot of protesting. And it's like, well, then don't go. Yeah. I mean, you know, but
it's just funny to conflate something. It's like a store. It's basically a department store. And people were talking about it like it was, you know, a monster.
Yeah. Beast you can't control.
It's like you can't control. Just don't shop there. And it's funny, we saw a documentary or something on the news about, and it was people talking about the negative effects of Walmart on their town and how is this and that and the other. And then they pulled out and everyone's in a Walmart parking lot talking about it. Right. You know, and they would all say, well, I think it's really lame, but I mean, I can't, you know, the prices are so good. What am I going to do? I can't refuse, you know, it's 12 totally packs of fucking, you know, paper towels.
It's totally Steinbeck. It's totally, it's totally Grapes of Wrath, where it's like, well, we can't control the bank. The bank does what it does. You know, we got to bulldoze your farm down because we wish we didn't, but we can't control it, you know. And
I also think there's some hypocrisy with people, like when you see people who are against globalization walking around on their cell phone, getting together a globalization protest. It's like, well, you have a cell phone. Like, you know what I mean? Like, look at you. You are globalization. You're on the internet organizing global anti-globalization protests. It's like, it was more about, it wasn't really a pro-Walmart or anti-Walmart thing. It was like, it's not Walmart, it's you, or it's us, or it's, you know, trying to kind of take it to a level of it's greed, or it's, you're never going to be
desire.
Desire. You're never going to tell people, well, don't buy something that's cheaper. It's like, people have an inherent, you know, need to make their life better. If they can do it by getting some cheap stuff at Walmart, then they're going to. But I love the end of this episode where Randy can't escape the burning haunted house that's falling in on itself because of the really good prices.
Yeah. I think that was I remember that was one of the first images we came up with. We didn't know what the show was going to be about, but we're like, we were basically, you know, the idea of treating Walmart as a being and as a haunted house, and you can't escape it once you get inside. And even though it's trying to kill you, you can't resist its bargains. That was definitely, that was the first idea of the show. And then we sort of built it up from there.
Yeah. And then they go to Bentonville, Arkansas, which is really where Walmart is headquartered.
Yeah.
And it's actually a really interesting place if you want to read about it sometime in your free time.
Yeah, because we did.
Yeah. It's actually pretty interesting. It's just a Walmart town.
All right.
So anyway, that's about this episode. Let's move on.
It's simple economics, son. I don't understand it at all, but God, I love it.
So this whole episode started from the idea we had kicking around a little bit called South Park Kids. You know, a lot of shows will be successful, and then they'll do the, let's do the kids version where they're all really young. We thought it'd be funny to do South Park Kids.
Yeah, South Park Babies.
Yeah, where they're all in kindergarten. So that was, or in preschool. So we were talking about, you know, let's just do a flashback show where it's all the boys and how they met in preschool and all this stuff. And that's where, sort of out of nowhere, this whole idea about maybe there's something they did that we're flashing back to kind of in a very Stephen King-it kind of way.
Right. And the guy's getting out of jail now. It's, what's that movie we kept talking about? Oh, Cape Fear.
Yeah.
It's a little bit like Cape Fear, too. The guy's getting out of jail.
And
he's been waiting to get you.
And there's also the big element here. We were trying to decide what is this horrible thing they did to their teacher, and when we realized they set her on fire, then it was an obvious jump to Star Trek episode, The Menagerie, Captain Christopher Pike in his little chair that can beep once for yes and twice for no.
By the way, is in that movie Trekkies. Remember that guy that builds his own?
Oh, yeah.
Some guy builds his own version of that, and he cruises around town.
We've had that whole thing where he beeps. They're like, did you do it, Trent? Or did he do this to you?
Right.
And it goes beep, beep. And he's like, yes, yes. Like that. We were so stoked on that. And then didn't we hear that somebody else had done it already? Like that the Simpsons had done it or something?
They had done that?
I can't remember. I don't know if it was, but I thought I remembered after this thing aired that somebody said, oh, you know, they did that joke on something. We were so bummed out. Dude, that was so funny.
And we thought that we came up with it, but you know, it didn't look
but it's good. Always fun, you know, when we have kids come in and do voices of, you know, real kids come in and do voices. I always like that.
Yeah. Start one, then we're gonna put it out. Look how cute they are. We're firemen. Do you
even know how to put out a fire? And oh, that's a good. We didn't actually have the kids swear. I remember I would write in the script like, do you big dummies even know how to, you know, start put out a fire? And then we would just beat big dummies, so it sounded like he said something horrible. And I remember my mom calling me the day after the show aired and going, what, now I don't know, like, I support everything you do, but I don't think you should have little kids saying things like that. And I was like, Mom, I didn't have them say that stuff. We could obviously beep whatever we wanted, it didn't matter what they said. She's like, oh yeah, I guess that makes sense.
Well, she believed it.
She believed it.
I think that's about it about this episode.
I can't think of anything else about this.
Anything else about this?
Let's move on.
Yeah, sounds good.
Children, get back away now!
This is closed circuit.
So this episode marks a very special time in South Park history because this was the first time we were officially out of ideas. and looking back on it, there's totally a reason for it. I mean, basically, if we can try to take you to this moment, it was November when we were doing this episode. Starting in January, we had done 7 episodes of South Park, then gone right into shooting a Team America, which was just brutal, then right into the post-production, then right into these, and basically had, you know, sort of fallen and scrambled our way through the first 3 episodes. And then I remember just being in the writer's room and just being like, man, I am so burnt out. And
we had literally had probably 5 or 6 days off in the entire year, including weekends.
And every other day was spent just racking your brain around trying to be creative, trying to rewrite Team America, trying to do all this stuff. And it was just fine. I was like, man, I can't do it. I can't do it. And so it really, I remember we were just sitting around there for hours and hours going, we got to come up with a show. We got to come up with a show. And then finally it was just, what if, you know, we love the idea when, we always love when the boys dress up as something and play something like little
detectives,
crime stoppers. Right. And it's like,
police.
All right, so what if they're little news reporters? Let's just do that. It was just like.
But it was really the idea started with the scenes that are later in this show where they're sitting around going, what are we going to do?
Yeah. How about a show where they got to come up with something and they can't come up with anything?
Yeah, that was kind of.
I remember first it was going to be just a show where they were sitting around in Stan's room saying, what do you guys want to do today? And they just couldn't figure out what to do.
Yeah.
And like that was going to be the whole 22 minutes was them in Stan's room going, dude, I cannot think of anything to do.
That's not cool.
Yeah,
let's
try
that.
A good idea. What about that? Because that's totally how we felt. And it definitely is, it was a crab people moment, you know, and crab people comes up in this again because crab people sort of now is the phrase for us when we just can't think of anything.
The ultimate like third act fucking cop out. Let's just get out of this.
It was basically like we did it first in South Park is Gay where we had a great show and we had an awesome setup and some fun second act stuff and then we just couldn't figure out a way out of it.
So we just go crab.
So
people.
It was like, what about people that think that are sort of half crab and half people?
That are
like,
from the center of the earth and want to take over?
And it was funny because half the people were like super stoked on crab people just because it is so dumb. But
well, maybe
like
not half. Maybe a quarter of people were stoked.
So then it was just like, you know, now in the writer's room whenever we're like, oh man, how do we do this? How do they get out of it? It's like crab people? Crap people, you know, and that means basically let's just bail, let's just give up. And then that was the thing.
This is like
that's my cat, that's Jake.
Yeah, my dog's in here someplace. That's my dog right there, Mr. Yes.
But that was the other idea was look, we can either do a show where it's they're in Stan's room and they can't think of anything to do, or let's just shoot really cute animals wide angle with a, you know, with a close up with a wide angle lens, and we'll just play that for 22 minutes and see what people think.
And it's like that when you read about, you know, you can work really hard on a show, whatever show it is, and try to put together an intricate storyline with all these twists and turns and funny moments, or you can just shoot animals close up with a wide angle lens, and that will guaranteed focus group better than your show. People all the time want to see puppies on TV.
That's true.
If you just put puppies on TV, people will just watch it.
I do think that the video we have of animals close up with a wide angle do save this episode.
It is the best part. That Benny Hill like music. I like when Butters throws his hair down finally and says, "Stupid news hair."
Yeah.
He didn't even know it's fake the whole time. I think that's funny. And I think it's funny when they trip. There's a part where they drink all the cough syrup in the end, and they trip. And there's one shot where Cartman's in the background and he's just looking at a wall, kind of. Remember that?
Yeah.
And that is exactly what a bunch of, that shot of them all tripping on the street is totally what a bunch of trippers look like when you see a bunch of people on acid or something. There's a guy looking at a wall going, wow.
That came out of, too, because we were sitting there in the writer's meeting going, okay, we can't come up with anything. And then it was like, maybe we should do some drugs and see what we come up with. And we know damn well that you come up with nothing on drugs. Never have come up with a good idea on drugs ever. And so we just decided to put that element in the show as well.
We're thinking about doing that next run. We're thinking about just one episode. We're just going to call it our drug episode, tell everyone we're going to do it. And then we're just going to take mushrooms and smoke weed and snort coke for like 6 days through just a personal experiment and put it on TV.
Just to show
here's what it is.
Just to show all the kids out there how crappy lame it would be. Yeah. We did not find
we'll
any success by
about
doing
it.
Drugs, I guarantee.
Yeah, we're going to get a way out. We're going to figure out some really funny shit, and the woods won't be funny.
It's funny, we actually have more to say about this episode where we couldn't come up with anything about anything else.
Just do commentaries.
I guess we'll move on. So this is our famous Paris Hilton episode, which I think we're very proud of. I like this episode.
Yeah, I think it's funny.
This was another one of those episodes that was out of nowhere. I mean, it was just sort of on a Thursday before it aired, we were just suddenly like, let's do a Paris Hilton episode. Because it was right when all the Paris Hilton guest jeans ads were coming out. And I was like, so pissed off, because I was like, that's where it finally reached the point of like, okay, now we're no longer telling little girls to laugh and mock this girl. We're actually telling little girls to emulate this girl, and that this girl is something to be looked up to. And it's just so pathetic because she's a stupid spoiled whore, and like how is that supposed to be something that little girls should look up to? I don't even have a daughter. If I had a daughter, I would be just livid. But you know, it's just amazing that people would allow that. I mean,
it's also like, you know, we've been to a, you know, living in LA. I don't know if I've seen her out. It's like I went to a party one time and she was there, but it's like I've never met anybody who has a nice thing to say about her, right? You know, but everyone can't wait to get her into their fucking party.
Right.
You know what I mean? And it's like, even the most highbrow, like, party you'll go to, and it's like, Paris Hilton's here. Oh, look, there she is. You know what I mean? And it's like, the fuck is wrong? Just don't let her in.
And, by the way, she's a dog. I mean, just, you know, it's like, it's not a newsflash or anything, but just like, that's what I thought too when I saw her.
Yeah, like, she has such an amazing figure. It's like, well, she's skinny and she's 22.
Yeah. It'd be one thing if I'd still be pissed off if it's like
weirdly like weird figure at 22. It's like,
but it's like if Guess Jeans wanted to make her a model and it's like, yeah, she's a stupid spoiled whore, but you know what? You got to admit she's super hot. It was like, at least I would kind of understand. All right, I guess I kind of get it. But it's like, she's a stupid spoiled whore and she's a total dog. Like, yeah. I guess it's just like watching a car wreck.
You know what? If her it's the combination with her last name being Hilton too.
Right. I
mean, it's like,
but it's, you know, really it's totally, you know, that she is miserable. She is the most miserable person on this planet. I guarantee it.
Her dog is really fucking miserable.
Yeah. I loved when we came up with that idea. The dog should shoot himself.
Yeah. Right here. Just thinking about it.
That took some.
And then the other good part about this episode is Mr. Slave just fucking jumps on her.
Yeah, and just shoves her up.
And then she's in Lemmy Wink's territory, and the Frog Prince makes a reappearance.
And by the way, that is men's spooge that she's coughing up into her hand, in case it wasn't clear. That is male spooge that somehow we were
this
able to...
This is funny right here. Oh, dear, I need another one.
All right, we'll move on.
We'll go laugh at some more of our own shit.
It's fun if I hang out with you. The other girls are acting really strange.
So this is Cartman's incredible gift, and I don't remember anything about this episode.
We're kind of sitting here trying to remember what we remember about it.
I remember
it was the hand guy, the serial hand murderer guy. Yeah, and
psychic detective,
and then the guy takes the hand and flips it around when he realizes. Oh,
see, this really proved it was basically now we're at basically.
Now we're just almost catatonic.
Yeah, we're totally catatonic. We've almost made it through the entire South Park season. We even made it through Quest for Ratings, where we actually rebounded from, okay, we're out of idea, we're done, we're burnt. We kind of got through that show. And then we did the Paris Hilton show, which we're like, oh, wow, that was pretty good. Maybe we do still got it. And then we came back to this week. We're like, oh, my God, no, we're done. We're fried.
Yeah.
And
I honestly can't remember what happened.
Pulled this episode out of our ass. And
what happens after they catch the serial murderer guy? The serial hand guy.
Oh, there's the the Red Dragon stuff where he's showing him the slideshow.
Oh, yeah. Do you see?
Do you see?
All the shitty travel photos. That was funny. And there you go. That's funny, too,
that,
right there.
That took a long time, actually, to animate that way to be funny. It was kind of funny, I guess. But it was also, obviously, it's, what's that Christopher Walken, Stephen King movie? Dead Zone.
Oh, Dead Zone, yeah.
It's sort of, it was all based on Dead Zone, where, you know, he gets hurt and then he wakes up and
he's convinced he can.
Cartman's wearing a little robe and walking around with a cane and obviously not seeing into the future at all. He's just seeing food items. Incredibly stupid.
He thought he could fly with cardboard wings. The stupidity is... Okay, that might be it.
That's really
That was pretty good. I think we remembered more than we thought we would.
I just remember now the feeling is just like, oh my God, we're about to pull off this year from hell. This is what we called the year from hell.
And we had
really just
6 weeks off after this.
Yeah, we've only got one more show to do. And we had no idea what that show was going to be. But it was like, if we can just make it this one more show... Then it's Christmas time, there's ham, and it's just going to be...
I like this little song, too.
Yeah, this is weird. This is like, what are we doing here?
And he's like,
oh, yeah, the face warmer. Oh, yeah, the face warmer.
Yeah, this is good, too.
Where's he got a beard? We just did that first, actually. It was just like, he should just have a beard, and we didn't. And then it was like 4 days later, we came up with a face warmer joke.
Take off that face warmer now. Been in a coma for some time. Hello. It's been 2 days. Nurse, you can remove his face warmer. So gratuitous. So stupid.
All right.
We'll okay, good. On. We saw what we wanted to see.
That was funny. At least another 2 days. So let me set the scene for you here. It's Thursday. We're 1 week away from our year from hell. And it
being over.
We can't believe we've actually made it. We actually made Team America. We actually had made 2 seasons of South Park all in 1 year. And it was about to be over. So now it's Thursday. We all sit down in the writer's room. And he's like, okay, guys, one more show, one more idea. What should we do? And nothing, just nothing. All day Thursday, just hours and hours and hours. And finally, we're like, it was like 9 p.m. And you're like, you know what? We got nothing. Let's go home. Got to go home, get some sleep, and see if we can come up with something tomorrow. Which already screws us super hard animation-wise because, you know, you're trying to do an animated show in 6 days. Now you suddenly take it to 5. We show up Friday, and just nothing. Talking circles. What about this? What about that? What about this? What about that? Nothing goes anywhere. And I'm sitting there going, "We got to call Comedy Central and tell them we're not gonna get an episode. We can't. There's nothing we can do." And then it was basically like, "Come on, are we really gonna have made it? Are we really gonna have come this far and done all of this just to, on the last show, not make it?" And I remember all day Friday just trying and nothing and that. And there was this little shred of an idea, which was, you know, the John Denver Critter Christmas, but that's all we knew was just like critter animals, woodland critter Christmas, like, but we couldn't figure out what's the idea, what is it. And it was, and then I kept saying, I don't want to do a Christmas show because whatever this show is, it's not going to be good because we don't have any time now to do it and we don't even have an idea, so I don't want to ruin the South Park sort of track record for Christmas shows and like make it a Christmas thing. Finally, it's Saturday morning. We're sitting there. We've got no idea. And the show's not going anywhere. Everyone's pulling their hair out because the animators are just sitting there with nothing to do. Now we've got 4 days to pull off an entire episode. And we're like, screw it. We're doing Critter Christmas somehow, some way. And I just start writing pages for In the Forest, all these critters. And we start talking about it more in time. And then I remember Saturday afternoon, it kind of broke. It was like, okay, they need Stan's help.
No, the thing that made us go, that's it, was Blood Orgy.
Right. They're satanic.
It was blood orgy.
Actually, devil worshippers.
Which was an idea that came from that movie Event Horizon, I think, with Lawrence Fishburne, yeah. Where they go out to this spaceship that they're not getting any signals from, and they're trying to figure out what happened to the crew, and all this supernatural stuff happens. And then they finally find the tapes of what happened to the crew, and it's just this fucking blood orgy where they're all eating each other and having sex, and it's just awful. It's like, oh, a terrible movie, and that's a sweet moment in it, though.
Then I remember we had to stay up super late Saturday and like try to figure stuff out. And then I went home and was still very unsettled because I was exhausted and like all nervous because I was like, how are we going to make this into a show? It doesn't make any sense. And then I remember Sunday we had the idea of like, what if this is all just a story that Cartman's telling? And all of a sudden it all clicked into place, right. And I was able to go and write like 15 pages.
Stan getting fucked over basically.
Yeah, by Cartman's story. And it'll all rhyme and it'll be the same. And it was just like, that's it. And so we scrambled Sunday. And I'll never forget the feel. I was driving home in my car on Sunday. And it dawned on me as we're driving home at like midnight. It was like, we're going to pull this off. Like the pages are in, animation's going pretty good. We're going to get a show done. It's going to be funny. This year, we did it. And I remember just roaring in my car. I roared like a lion. And I didn't mean to. It just came out of me. And I was just sitting there behind the wheel going, rah! And just screaming. And I was just like, wow, that's pretty messed up. But it was a pretty great feeling to know we had pulled that year off. And I swear I will never put myself in that position again. But it turns out this is one of my favorite shows.
Oh, I love this episode. Show. Yeah, a lot of these voices were inspired by that Henson thing.
Yeah.
What is it? The Watership Down? Not Watership Down. What is it? It's like.
It was like beavers on a river.
Otters.
Otter Christmas or something. Which was horrible.
Yeah.
It was one of those things where, like, remember that as a kid? That was so great. And we went and got the video and we're watching it going, oh my God, this is crap.
Most Christmas things and holiday things from our youth at least, you know, you like them because of the nostalgic feeling, but they're not very good, really. Yeah.
But this, on the other hand, is really good.
Yeah, this is really sweet. And that's about it.
So, yeah, in summation, overall, seeing as though we made it and finished and started a feature film in the midst of all this, I think we did a pretty good job.
Yeah,
I give us a B+ on this.
I'm going to say B+. I'm going to say B++.
Well, thanks. We'll see you all at season 9. Every Christmas, the mountain lion comes down and eats the virgin critter impregnated with the son of our Lord.